Thank you. Greetings, fellow humans. I'm going to talk about functional package management with GNU Geeks for developers and power users. Please accept my apologies for this pretentious title, but I thought I should point out that this is not going to be a very general introduction, but I'm trying to aim this at this audience, which hopefully includes developers and power users. I always like to start with a bold statement in pink. Package managers are really useful. I think this claim is true, but the package managers are also really, really frustrating. Maybe this is just me, but one of the first problems I always have with package managers is that the software that is provided through those package managers is usually old software. So I try to update this, and I can't because there are version conflicts with dependent libraries. So I try to upgrade those libraries, and then I realize that this breaks. So upgrades are not something that usually works. It's often something that you don't do when you're on a deadline or when you're due to submit some project, because who knows if it works, right? Even worse, the only way is forward. So once you've upgraded, you're committed, right? You can't go back. Or if you can, it's really, really hard to go back. That's really bad on shared systems. Like if you have a workstation at home that is not only used by you, but your kids, or your partner, or friends who hang out, I don't know. These changes affect all of those users. And if they're unhappy with the latest version of Emacs that you've just installed, well, bad for them, I guess. It's even worse in scientific environments when you've got big shared cluster environments and the system administrator decides to upgrade GCC to some new version or decides not to upgrade it. Maybe installs an ancient version that ought to work for everybody and usually doesn't. Well, that's bad. And all of these problems track down to the fact that package managers in general are imperative and stateful. Stateful meaning that you've got this global environment, slash bin, or slash lib, or slash user, slash bin, right? And the package managers modify or manipulate that state. And there's really nothing you can do about that, right? So there's no way to isolate changes or to roll back to a previous state that is exactly the same as it used to be. There are some fixes to that, which are usually incomplete and not satisfactory. So what I hear some of you think is that, what about using what I like to call big binary bundles, such as using Docker images or virtual machines or whatever these things are called? So big blobs that include everything, all the dependencies, and they are just neatly isolated in that tarball I can unpack somewhere. Well, to me, big binary bundles are indistinguishable from giving up. You're no longer dealing with packages. You're dealing with big binary blobs, right? They are not composable. It's just the wrong level of abstraction. No longer dealing with packages. You can't do what you're used to doing with packages. You don't share automatically. Everything is a pain with big binary bundles. So, having quickly established that big binary bundles are not the way to go, let's introduce functional packaging. Functional does not mean it works, like that functional. Here at this conference, I think everybody knows what functional means, namely as in a mathematical function sort of thing. So with functional packaging, we just pretend that the build process for packages behaves like a purely mathematical function. That is, you've got inputs, and you've got outputs. Given the same set of inputs, you have the same set of outputs. Inputs are header files, sources, the build tools, the compiler, all the libraries, and their dependencies recursively. Outputs are like the tree of files that is generated. And what's crucial here is if you've got the same input, you always get the same output. There's a little asterisk there, which you don't see, because that's not always the case, unfortunately. That requires bit-for-bit reproducibility, which people are working on. But in general, you can say, given the same input, you want to have the same output. On the other hand, having different input, no matter how slightly they differ from one another, you will get different output. In this case, I was building an old version of Emacs, and with the same input to the build function, like having the same header files, the same libraries, using the same compiler, all the way down the graph, I always expect to get this output. And you see, it starts with a hash here. This cabbage thing is a hash that encodes all of the input. So given all the same input, I'll always have the cabbage here. And all the outputs are stored in a directory prefix that depends on those inputs. Any different input will give me a different prefix directory because all of the inputs are encoded in that hash. So given even the same version, but a slightly different variant of Emacs, I will have a different prefix directory with different outputs. So this is not a perversion thing, but a per-variant thing, if you will. Now, GnuGeeks is one implementation of this functional package management paradigm, and this is the way it works. You have a Geeks client that you can run as a user, which uses Geeks as a library, and that library on your behalf communicates with a build daemon that is privileged. That build daemon then spawns off isolated build processes as a unprivileged user. And inside of these build environments, the only thing that's there is what you've declared to be there. So it by default has no access to global values like /bin or /lib. Everything has to be declared. As a result, the build will fail if it requires anything that you did not declare. Right? That's by design. The build process, once it completes, has some output, and that output is cached away in what we call the store. Now, if a user asks for Emacs to be built, the Geeks client will send an RPC to the build daemon and says, please build me Emacs. And the build daemon will check, do I already have Emacs in the store with those same versions of inputs? If I already have it, well, I can just return the output directly. I don't have to recompute it. Right, this is referential transparency. We've got where it's indistinguishable whether a function performs work or not. It could either perform work or it could look up the result in the lookup table. That's something you cannot determine, right? Which is great. As a result, we get the same values for the same input at all times, and the store acts as a cache. Now, I would like to show you really quickly how this works. So say if I build Python, can you see that? I build Python, and here's an output. And so Python, I cannot tell if Python was just compiled in time or if it was in my store already. Actually, I can, because it would take a little longer, right? But the result is the same. In this case, it was already in my store, and it was saved in /gnu/store, big long hash, which I'm not showing here, followed by Python something. If I take a look at this, I see that inside of that directory, in terms of this neatly prefixed directory, there is a tree of directories with bin, Python, and all the libs that Python needs, and so on. Okay, but nobody would like to have to remember something like this, right? /gnu/store, big long hash, minus Python, minus 3 point something, blah, bin, Python 3. This would get old really quickly. So there's a slight optimization that you can do on that, which is software profiles. So let's assume that this is my profile. It's in my home directory. There's a link.geeks profile, which is really just a link to some state directories file called geeks profile, which is the current profile. That is a link to the current version or generation of my profile. And that, in turn, is just a link to the actual profile in the store. Everything that Geeks build ends up in the store one way or another. So here's a profile, which, as you might have guessed, is again not actually containing the actual tools that I have in my profile, but these are links to the actual store items that are completely isolated. So in this case, I've got in my profile a bin directory with the SEM tools executable, and that is actually just a link to the SEM tools output in the store, bin SEM tools. Same for Bowtie 2, which is an executable that is in its own output. To the user, it seems as if these both of these tools, the trees of SEMTools and Bowtie, were unified, and they appear as .geeks.profile/bin/lib/include/whatever. Okay, so for a user, all they need to remember is to put that thing on their path. They don't need to remember anything that happens in the store. Now, the store is append only. So if I were to remove something, what actually happens? Here I removed Bowtie from my profile. But as you see, all of that is still the same, right? What happened is Geeks created a new profile for me where Bowtie is just missing. And the link of what the current profile is just points to the current version of my profile, the current generation of my profile. So it is trivial to go back in time, right? I can just flip symlinks here. Okay, so rollbacks are a feature you get for free. But say I actually wanted to free up space. I actually want to remove Bowtie. What I would do then is remove that profile generation. Right, so now the link is missing. He used to be a 42 and was pointing at this profile. What Geeks can now determine is that this profile is not referenced by anybody. Nobody needs this thing, so I can remove this. And now the links to Bowtie have been removed as well, so it can also remove Bowtie. This is called garbage collection. It just does so by counting references, really. But enough of this, and I'd like to show you how this works. So this is a demo, which means it probably will fail. Let's see. I'll greet you first, because that's... I don't have the hello command. I can't greet you. But I could install the hello command. See if that works. It tells me the following package will be installed. This is the hello package at version 2.10. I don't know what the previous versions did. And it ends up in the store at this long path. Let me hide this again, because I don't care. Now I have one package in my profile, and let's see. Greetings. Now Geeks package minus I for installed packages shows me I have one package in my profile. And if I look at the list of generations that I have, I see I have one generation that was installed just now, which contains one of these packages. Now, only having the hello package is kind of boring, so let's install Python, which already is in our store, so we just need to add it to our profile. And it says a lot of things here. What does it say? It says that, well, we ignore this part. This is not important. There are two packages in our profile now. There's a new Python package, and obviously there's a hello package from last time, and it tells me that I might have to extend, I might have to set an environment variable. This is done automatically for me. I could just source a file it generates. So now I have Python 3 here. You may notice that it does something funny here, right? This is by design. We want to have reproducible builds, and timestamps are opposing this goal, because having a different timestamp in a binary, embedded in a binary, means that the output is going to be different. So by design, we reset timestamps to zero. Okay, now I've got Python in here, and I can take a look at all the generations I have here. I've got a generation 1 from just now. Generation 2, which is the current generation, where I've got Python in there. And looking at just all of the packages I have installed, you see both packages are there. Now, I realized installing Python at a conference, this is about functional programming, probably not a good idea. So I just roll back. And now you see it says, I've switched from generation 2 to 1. And if you look at this, the output is pretty much the same as before, except that the current marker has moved. So what happened in the background, right, is that the link was switched. The other profile is still there. I could just switch back to generation 2 if I really, really wanted to have Python, which I don't. So now I can do garbage collection, right? I can delete generation 2 or all the non-current generations of my profile and free that up for garbage collection for the future. Okay. Now on to the implementation. This is Scheme. And how many people here are familiar with Lispy things? So many. I'm so happy. How many people have actually used Scheme before? Sweet. Okay, but first I'm going to show all those people who haven't used Scheme before a little introduction. So you probably have seen those things, right? Some people call them nail clippings. I like to call them parentheses. And this is the foundation of it. You will see those everywhere. And at some point, you will ignore those, I guess. So everything that's within those parentheses is either a procedure or an atom or something. Everything at the very beginning is special. So the first item here is a procedure, and it's applied to all the rest of the arguments. Now, if I don't want to evaluate code, I can quote it, right? So this is just data. So think of the quote as turning on data mode. There's a slight variant of this, same thing, but this is a toggle switch, right? Right now, it is in data mode, and if I flip it down, I enter code mode. Okay, so what happens here is, this is all data, code. This is evaluated. And then the rest is data again. Okay, one more thing on syntax. So these things are called keyword arguments. So going back to this, now this should be really, really easy for you. This defines a variable that is bound to some value, namely a package object. A package object is a really simple thing. It has a couple of fields here that are pink: name, version, source, build system, inputs, argument, and so on. This reads a lot like data. There's not much code going on here. So the package has a name, glpk, it has a version, it has a source. We skip over the source, and we look at the build system, which is special. So the build system is a value, and that value encodes pretty much everything about how to build this package. The GNU build system is the usual thing, right? Configure, so first you have a tarball, you unpack it, then you run configure, then make install. This is all abstracted away in this little innocent value GNU build system. This package has inputs. As I said before, all inputs must be declared. And this declares that we've got a list of inputs. This one is a label, so we can refer to it elsewhere in the arguments, for example. It has inputs, and this is a quoted list. So this thing is unquoted, meaning that this is not just some symbol. This is the actual value of a package, GMP. This is an actual value, not a name, a value. That is important. If you take a look at this now, GLPK, that is a package object. And I can take a look at the inputs of this package. And it says there's GMP, and there's an actual package value. I could go down that graph. I could say, show me the package inputs of GMP. GMP. Oh, it's got no input. Well, that's too bad. But it's got so it's got no direct input, but it has inputs that are implied through the GNU build system. Anyway, if I continue this for long enough for all of the inputs, both direct inputs, native inputs, and implicit inputs, I will describe a whole graph of things that span the dangle from GLPK. Okay? So this is a lazily evaluated graph that we're dealing with. A little bit on the rest here. Arguments are things that we pass to the build system. So here we say we pass configure flex with GMP because we're building with GMP. And the rest is just data. It's not very interesting. But what happens here is that this is sufficient to describe the GLPK package. Source describes how to get it, right? How to download it. URL fetch is just one of the many methods that we could use to download things. There's also git fetch for git references and hg fetch for Mercurial stuff. And you see here that there's a funny hash in there, which we use to ensure that the package we are actually downloading, the tarball we're downloading, is as expected. Okay. What's the time? Do I have enough time left? Yeah, good. The graph, right. Let me show you one of these graphs. These are the dependencies of the R package. These are just all those packages I need to have in order to build R. This big hairball here. So this is R. And R has just a couple of dependencies, direct dependencies, but they have a couple of other dependencies again. And if you wanted to build R or start hacking on R, right, it's just a matter of installing all the dependencies, right? Geeks to the rescue. Geeks makes it a little easier to do that, so we just do geeks environment R, and it does things. It will compute all the dependencies of R and throw me into an environment. As you can see, this env stands for environment. I'm now in an environment where all of the dependencies I need to hack on R are available. So I already downloaded the R sources here. And I can just start configuring things and start hacking on it. But that's not interesting. Geeks environment is like a virtual env that you might know from Python, or like, yeah, there are a lot of tools like this, but they're usually confined to just one language, one implementation, one language. Whereas Geeks environment works for pretty much everything. Right? You can say Geeks environment, not just R, but in addition to that, I also plan on hacking on the autoconf stuff. So I add a couple of autoconf and automake and so on. And that's going to give me an environment with all the dependencies I need for R, plus autoconf, plus automake. It's just a little slow on my computer, but here we go. And so on. Now, Geeks environment is more flexible than that. You can also run things in containers. As I said before, there are these big binary bundles, right? And people usually conflate those things. They use them for reproducing environments and for making it easy to contain things. So these are two things, right? Reproducibility and containing processes. With Geeks environment container, we're using the kernel API directly. And we can say, I want to have like core utils in here. So give me an environment in a container that contains core utils like ls. And as we see, I'm root in there. Right? This is my separate user namespace where my user is UID0. And as I exit, I'm my usual self again. So you don't actually need Docker to run processes in isolation. You can do the same thing with Python or whatever you want, really. And this will be completely self-contained. So this is Python again, but in an environment where nothing else is available. See, ls is not even there because I didn't tell it to include the core utils. Now, since we've got the complete graph of dependencies in a scheme library, we can do funny things with that. We could, for example, write different user interfaces on top of Geeks that use Geeks as a library. So here's a thing that's called Geeks Web. And I'm using Geek's environment to enter an environment that is predefined in a file. It gives me all the tools I need to hack on Geek's web. And now I can do Geek's web. And that's a nice little web interface written in Guile scheme, which takes a little long to load. There we go. And that is using the whole dependency graph that we have as a library to implement a web interface through which we can install packages if we wanted to. So here, all of the inputs are available. I can just follow them through until I hit a leaf node. So this is really powerful stuff. So we can use the graph as a living thing, right? It's code, and it's also data. And we can just use it in our tools. That's pretty neat, I think. Of course, we also have an Emacs interface, right? So here, the Emacs interface allows me to directly hack on packages. Say I want to hack on Emacs. Here we go. This is the definition of Emacs, and I can go hack on it, and I can build my variants if I want to. Okay. Now, people usually ask me, and I would like to anticipate this question, how does Geek's differ from Nix? So you may have heard of Nix. Who has heard of Nix? Oh, great. So many people. So Geek's and Nix, they're not rival projects. There's no enmity between those two projects. We're actually two different implementations of the very same idea, which is functional package management. And one of the former developers of Nix started the Geek's project. I guess because that person was also the maintainer of Guile scheme. It seems natural to extend this whole idea of having functions that represent build processes in one unified general purpose language. So the decision to use one general purpose language, namely scheme, to represent both packages and to do operations on the package to provide a complete graph of dependencies in a language that is general purpose language seemed just like a natural fit. In the Nix language, which is especially developed language just for the purpose of describing Nix packages, you actually see the relation of Nix packages to the functional package management paradigm, because Nix expressions are functions, right? In Geek's, functions are not that important anymore. As I've shown you, we've got packages. Packages are first class in Geek's. And these packages lazily describe the graph of dependencies. So that's a little different here. This is 10 minutes for the talk, or including the Q&A. It's without. So what Geek's as a project reuses of Nix is the daemon and the derivation format. So packages are compiled to bags, and bags eventually lead to derivations, which are the build instructions that the daemon performs. In Geek's, however, everything is written in Guile. So when we augment, say here, when we augment the build steps, none of this is shell script. We are not pasting strings together, but we're using a general purpose language to do all of the things. So as you can see here, we use proper scheme to create directories. We're using install file rather than whatever the bash equivalent would be. So it's one unified language that spreads throughout the whole system. Now, Geek's is not just a package manager, but it's also the foundation of a system called Geek's SD, Geek's System Distribution, which is a very creative name. And I'm running Geek's SD here on this machine. This Geek's SD extends the idea of having declarative descriptions of your package environment, your software environment, to the system level. So I can take a look at an actual description of my system. This is just scheme codes. Here's operating system. That is a value that describes completely my operating system. So it has a host name, time zone, locale, whatever, particular kernel, namely Linux Libre. The initrd is written in Guile as well. And everything else about users and groups and packages that should be installed for everybody, plus services, are just written in Scheme. And we can instantiate this to an actual system. So I could just do geeks system build and then path to the configuration file. And this would build me a whole system, place it somewhere in the store. And I could make this my current system and boot it. And if it turns out that this is broken, this system, I could just select in grub the previous version, as you know from NixOS as well. You can just boot the previous version and have no worries anymore. So I actually upgraded my system just before the talk. And luckily nothing broke, but if it had something broken, I could have just rebooted in the previous version. As you can see, this is just a system that includes a boot directory, that includes an etc directory, that has an initrd written in Guile, the kernel directory, and a profile. And that profile contains like the usual root directory, right? So all the sbin stuff, the bin stuff is in there, all the libraries. And that's currently installed here as well. So if I check out run current system, I see the same thing, right? So this whole idea of managing packages neatly extends to the operating system level. And we are close to getting to a point where we can not only manage individual machines, but doing DevOps kind of thing. Right? So NixOS already has this. We are getting there too. 5 minutes. Okay. Actually, I think we can take questions now already, then we have a little more time for that. Because there are not so many people here, so I guess we can take questions from more people. Any questions so far? Yes.
So that basically means like every dependency I have under control is still the same. The only dependency is the operating system, which I don't have under control because of that security fix. And in the end, I have to get a different binary package. So it's like in the end, I didn't change anything, but I have different results.
Okay, I try to compress. Yes, I would like to summarize this question. It's very hard, though. So the question is, if I install a set of packages, then the operating system has a security fix or security upgrade, and I reinstall the same packages, the binaries might be different. Is that the gist of it? Right. In Geeks and in functional package management in general, you don't have those worries, because a single package closes over the complete dependency graph. So it's not only the package and its direct dependencies, like the libraries it may need, but also those libraries and their dependencies and their build tools, all the way down to, down to what, really? Right? Down to the roots of the graph, obviously. And those roots of the graph are a handful of bootstrap binaries, like a static living Guile, makedir, tar, xz, so that you can unpack the first libc and the first compiler and so on. So the whole graph is rooted in bootstrap binaries, and they don't change. So they are completely independent of your operating system. It's hard to say what the operating system is in that case, because, hey, is the libc part of the operating system? Well, in Geeks and in functional package management in general, the libc is part of the dependencies of your package. So you can have multiple versions of that libc available as well. So the package itself is unaffected by changes to the operating system. We use this to this property a great deal where I work. Oh, and I should not forget this. I should thank my employer, so that this counts as work time. I thank the MDC for letting me explain Geeks to people here. So I'm working in a scientific environment where we have a big cluster, and people want to have reproducible software environments, and they want the environment that is on the cluster to be the same as on their workstation. But usually they run different systems. On the workstation it might be Ubuntu something, and on the cluster it's CentOS ancient point really old. And the software environment is completely self-contained because it also contains its own libc. Right? The only thing that is not controlled for is the kernel. Yeah. But in most cases that I've encountered so far, it doesn't really matter. Because we have the kernel headers as well as part of the graph, and these are pretty old, so as to cover a whole wide range of kernels. And in most cases, this is just sufficient. You have the same problem with other systems that build on top of the kernel, right? But that's like the minimum base that we can get on. I hope this answers the question. Okay. Yes. Yes. So since each package describes or closes over the complete graph, any change down close to the root of the graph will require a rebuild. Right. So if you've got a security problem in libc, you've got to rebuild everything, and that can be really painful, and it can take a very long time. So what we do is we try to optimize this by using what we call grafts. So like a tissue graft, right? It doesn't change anything in the store, but it takes what already exists in the store, copies it, and changes all the embedded references to vulnerable libraries with a newly built library. This way we can rebuild one of the core libraries and just patch or create copies that are then patched to contain references to the updated library. And that buys us enough time to rebuild the whole world and provide binary substitutes that people can then download easily. That's just an optimization, and it is usually safe. In some pathological cases, it's not. Like when OpenSSL issues a new version and that completely breaks ABI, the binary interface. In that case, you might have problems. And then what we do is we just rebuild the world. Yeah.
Can you choose different versions of packages?
Absolutely. So we've got not only since every package ends up in its own prefix directory, it's not only different versions of a package, but different variants of a package that also end up in different directories. And you can either put them in the same profile, or you can install them into different profiles.
And you have them all in the package store?
They all end up in the store. They all end up in the store. But what you put in your profile is up to you. Right? The store is used for deduplication. Right. So the question is about different variants of packages in the library. Sure, you can. They wouldn't have the same name, right? If I wanted to have a variant of Emacs, I would inherit from the Emacs package description and change a couple of things there. So I do this in the bioinformatics module, SemTools, which is a commonly used tool that breaks compatibility with every version. So here's SemTools version 1.3.1, and here I've got another variant of SEMTools, and a different version that inherits from SEMTools. So we get most of the we get all of the fields that SEMTools, the package, describes, and override a couple of things like the version, where to get the sources, and a couple of special arguments that are needed in order to get to build. Bioinformatics software is weird, so this is often needed special treatment because they don't use proper build systems. Yuck. Yes. I don't see the so is it is the question is Geeks a viable replacement for apt-get or pacman, or can I only use it for development purposes? I don't see the difference, frankly, because developers are just users with peculiar needs. You sure can use it as a package manager on top of other systems. So at work, I'm using it on top of Ubuntu instead of apt-get, or on top of CentOS instead of, I think, Yum. And I'm using it in GeeksSD as the native package manager, obviously. It just gives users the ability to customize their environment, which is what other package managers make really hard. So the distinction between what a user and what a developer is gets blurred. And that's one of the goals of the GNU project in general. Yes, please. The question is, do I have to write a lot of scheme, or can I expect packages to be available already? We've got about 4,500 packages, which is not a lot, but considering the age of Geeks, which is just about 4 years or so, 5 years maybe, I don't know, I guess 4.5, don't quote me on this, it's growing really well. And no, you don't have to write a lot of scheme, you can let Scheme write Scheme for you. We've got a couple of importers that generate code also recursively. So at work I have to package a lot of R packages, and since this gets really tedious, I just type Geeks import from CRAN or from Bioconductor this package recursively, and it produces a whole lot of Scheme code that I can copy paste into either my personal package library or into Geeks upstream and submit as a patch. So it's, you don't have to learn a whole lot of Scheme. And in most cases, packages look simple. Like for the statistics module here, look at this R color space. It's, that reads like data. It's, there's hardly any Scheme in there. Right? It's a, well, if you ignore the parentheses, obviously. One last question. The question is, isn't that risky? That if I change something on the bottom of the graph somewhere and have to rebuild all of the packages that depend on this, either directly or indirectly, yes, this is risky in that you cannot, it's not guaranteed, obviously, that software is going to work, that software is buildable. But this is a problem that is solved by continuous integration. So we're building everything all the time. Whenever something changes, whenever a library down there changes or up there, it doesn't really matter where in the graph, we're just rebuilding things. And things might break. And in that case, you can choose not to upgrade, right? Because the thing cannot be built, obviously. You can also upgrade everything else, but keep that piece of software that you so urgently need unupgraded. So do not upgrade LibreOffice, for example. So there is granularity there. But this is really a problem that is outside of the scope of geeks. It's more of a continuous integration problem and quality assurance. So this is what distributions are there for. Distributions are supposed to make sure that users run into as little problems as possible. And one of the tools is continuous integration, which we do.